Hello and welcome to another episode of Curator with a Camera. I'm Anthony Coulls, Senior Curator of Rail Transport and Technology at the National Railway Museum. And today we're at Locomotion in Shildon to look at this, the Northeastern Railway snowplough.
Snow showers in the areas around York, Middlesbrough and Darlington have affected rail traffic.
Up here in County Durham, there have been many occasions over the centuries where trains have been snowed in, specifically on the Stainmore line, which runs across the North Pennines from east to west, from Barnard Castle, West Auckland, over to Tea Bay and Penrith. There have been many accidents and incidents which led to the need to create an amazing piece of railway technology built to do a specific job. The Northeastern Railway met this challenge quite literally head on with this magnificent creation, the Northeastern Railway snowplough of 1891. It's quite breathtaking, really, because there's nothing in the collection quite like it. Built to bash its way through 13, 14 feet deep drifts, we really do have snow drifts this deep in the northeast, even now. This prow has to hit a snowdrift at speed with the best part of maybe 200 tons of locomotive providing force behind it. And how does it do that? What you have and how it does its business is a blade, an iron blade, set 4 to 6 inches above the rails. That gets under the snow, and it's set at a 30 degree angle. So that gets under the snowdrift and pushes the snow up. The snow then meets the prow, pretty much like the prow of a ship, and that then blasts the snow to the left and the right. It's been likened to a warship. That's also reflected in the strength of how it's made. You have this massive frame. Everything here, the timber is huge, it's solid, and it's given extra weight inside the underframe here. There were quite often extra castings, whether they were broken down number plates or brake blocks or bits of scrap, to give this the extra weight that it needed to hit those drifts. The wheels are hidden by these hatches underneath. You can see the skirting extends all the way down to the track. There's no point in getting snow stuck in the wheels and getting your plough stuck, because that pretty much defeats the object of the vehicle itself. So the snow plough has to go between sites, from its depot to where there's a drift. And until it gets to where the drift is, and they'll know where the drifts are, it has to be treated as a normal train. So there is a lamp bracket here that folds up and down that you can put your lamp on to indicate the class of train that it is. And if you're going in the other direction, there would be a tail lamp placed on this. But of course, it falls flat quite nicely like that, so that when the plough is being pushed into the snow has a seamless journey and transition up and over to the side of the line. And there, on the side, we've restored the plough to its Northeastern Railway condition as it was when it was new in July 1891. There's no point building snow ploughs in the winter because you need them there. So this one and its sister, number 11, were built at Gateshead in July 1891 and initially turned out in this Indian red livery of the Northeastern Railway. And as with all Northeastern Railway goods vehicles, such as brake vans, there's a red end there, the red there to distinguish it, that you could tell that this was meant to be the end of a train, end of the vehicle. as well as having an end lamp there. And there is its weight on the side, painted, 23 tons. Moving to the back of it, we see the difference here in the what's called the draw gear, the buffing gear. This wagon that it's attached to on the left has a conventional sprung buffer, which you expect, but bear in mind the buffers take forces, and when you're hitting the snow, as we've said before, you want to hit it hard. And so the plough has what's called dumb buffers, so there's no resistance in the springs. They're just solid blocks of timber, probably oak, with iron facing sheets, and the engine is tied up tight to these. And so there'd be a locomotive here rather than another wagon, and the locomotive is shoving as hard as it can to drive that plough through the drift. There were occasions where the snowdrifts were so deep and so packed that even 100-ton goods engines pushing the snowplough were damaged because of the forces involved when they hit that snow. But what of the people who operated this plough? What of the men who were sent out to site to work on the plough, to dig the snow? Let's go and have a look inside their world, inside the snowplough. This really is an incredibly small space. It's about 6 feet by 8 feet, maybe 8 feet by 8 feet. So this is in essence a mobile mess room. So the guys travel here to the site of the drift on these bench seats. You've got to imagine that we're in here on a winter's day, and you've got half a dozen people in here, maybe eight, all sitting in close proximity. They're all smoking fairly vile cigarettes, and the stove is on. It's going to get quite atmospheric in here. There's a handbrake there for parking up of the plough, because these snow ploughs would have spent quite a lot of the year idle. The North Eastern Railway was perhaps the largest builder and user of snow ploughs in the whole of England, really. And you can see that massive construction from the outside continues on the inside. Very strong roof sticks. Braced it here, the iron strap across from side to side on the body. Lamp brackets all around. Light, very important. There's a hand lamp there. So these are not lamps necessarily for illumination in the van, but they're hand lamps that will help with signalling out on the job to the drivers and the crews of the engines. So why is there a door here? Let's go and have a look through the door and see what else we can see. You can just see again this massive construction that there is to withstand the stresses of hitting snow drifts at 30, 35, 40 miles an hour. These are huge cross timbers bracing side to side, and then the diagonal timbers here with these reinforcing brackets there taking that full stress. This isn't just idle space, this is storage space. So you can put stuff underneath here. For example, there's a track gauge, because of course once you've cleared the line you want to make sure that the permanent way is still correct of the standard gauge. And then round here, your sole source of warmth on those Pennine winters, a stove all the way through to the ceiling. North Eastern Railway cast there, so all made in-house. And this is the only source of heating that you have, both for keeping warm and for cooking. So whilst there's the chimney out the back there, you can take the plate off and put a pan or a bowl or a kettle on the top there. And then behind the door, another cupboard for storage. And once again, that incredible bracing all the way through. And some more space to put things that you require to, because quite often the train might be off the track that you're going to go and rescue if there is a train stuck in a drift. And therefore you'd need things like the re-railing jacks, you need tools, you need spanners, shovels, hammers, stuff that was the tools of the trade for the permanent way gang and the snowplough teams. It seems amazing that something built in 1891 should still have ancestors in use by Network Rail to this day. But if you travel on the East Coast Main Line and are passing through places like York and Peterborough, you will still see a pair of snowploughs stabled awaiting the day for those drifts to come. It's a striking monument, both to the people who designed and built it and created it, but also to the snowplough teams who worked with these things day in, day out, through the hard winters every year that came to the Northeast. Thanks for joining us today for our look at the Northeastern Railway snowplough, an amazing piece of railway technology built to do a specific job. If you've enjoyed it, why not like and share and subscribe so that you don't miss out on future episodes of Curator with a Camera.